Next speaker, Peter Warman from Nuzu, fills a really critical piece of the games as a service business. We all know, because people have stood up here and talked about it for the last several years, that data is really, really important. And oftentimes, as a developer, when you go down this path and you start collecting data about your game and you start seeing these numbers like, oh, I don't know, $1.70 ARPU, right? And your very first thought when you look at this data is, that's awesome. What does it mean? Data is really difficult to do anything with unless you have a baseline, unless you have things to compare it to. Maybe that's very, very good for your game. Maybe that's really crappy for your game, but it doesn't mean anything until you have something to compare it to. And Nuzu, Peter's company, gives you some of those baselines to compare your data to and understand where you fit in terms of the continuum of what's possible. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Peter. Thank you very much, Peter.
Yeah, I'm wired again. Thank you very much, David. I am a data nerd. That is indeed true. And I'm gonna show you some data, which hopefully you will find cool. But I put this picture up because I also want to share with you a new way or different way of looking at the market, which hopefully would inspire you or maybe even be practical in use. This is actually a piece of art which hangs in our office at Nuzu. It's about this big. It's made by Dice, the creators of Mirror's Edge. And there's a Dutch company that then asked the designer to develop a specific piece of art, and they print it very nicely, and then they make 18 pieces. And this is number two, and number one is in the office of Dice. And it's an example of a game brand that extends into, very scary, the real world. And that's one of the things I want to talk about today, that there's more than metrics. I'm metric crazy, but there's more than that. And I do a lot of research, or we do a lot of research, financial data, transactional data, but also a lot of consumer research. And if you do consumer research, you want a well-balanced panel of people. So enough people that are highly educated, people that don't have a lot of brain power, male, female. And to be able to do a lot of research at home, I spoke to my wife about 9 years ago and 9 months. And we created the perfect panel because we have one girl and one boy exactly the same age. So this is my favorite research panel. They're called Ruby and Dani. Boy and a girl, twins. So in this research panel, if I follow them, we see the following thing happen. On the entertainment screen, or used to be called the TV screen, they play co-op Lego Star Wars like crazy. That's actually an action shot. And then another time of the day, this is Dan, he says hi. He's playing on the computer screen. A different screen, but he's playing games there. And then I caught him on the couch with my iPad, and he was playing games again. Red alert there, but he plays Clash of Clans as well. And that's we call it the floating screen. So the tablet is something completely different than the mobile phone, because a tablet floats around the house and fills the gaps where you don't have access to another screen. Because the personal screen, as we call it, is a smartphone. And you have it in your pocket, it's personal. If you have one, you also want a tablet. Well, this is the female side of my research panel in Vietnam, lying in bed with my iPhone, playing a game. So even my kids are only 9 years old, that they use all the four types of screens to play games all the time. And a real funny thing happened. My lovely wife on the beach of Vietnam played her first game of her life. She got Simon on the iPad. She knows Simon from when she was young, long, long, long time ago. And she's now a first-time gamer. And she's 43 years old. I'm approximately that age. So those two screens have brought her in as a new gamer. So a lot of my presentation will include those two new screens. Just some facts, because I'm very much into facts. It's not only my kids that do that, but 17% of all German gamers already play games on all those four screens. So that's 6.5 million Germans. And actually the Brits are the most multi-screen people in the world with 26%, and the US is in between, 22%. So the Germans are below average, but we expect that to increase. Just another fact about dads. I was talking about my kids, so I need to have a fact about dads. The majority of dads with kids at home that spend money on tablets or smartphones, even 71%, spends that money mainly for their kids. So 71% of 6 million paying American dads do that. And the bad news is it's only 46% for moms. Shame on you, moms. That's data, and I think we all are in a very busy state when it comes to work. There's so much happening, so much to do. So we're very lean forward, and we have dinner behind the computer, and you know, we're diving into metrics and stuff. And I just want to ask, you know, let's lean back for a moment and look at this bigger picture and see what we can learn from that, which is new. So let's take a bird's eye view, realizing that these screens, these two, did not exist 5 years ago. We only had two screens, and now we have four screens that we play games on. A doubling of the number of screens. That has a big impact. So if you put these four screens around the consumer, cut out all the jargon about games, an important thing is to remind that there's things that connect these screens, and I think there's three. So one is social networks, the cloud, and in the end, also the real world. And why am I showing this? Because, for instance, the term social gaming, you know, the social gaming bubble has burst. You read that in the press. Well, that's all double BS, because social gaming is still growing, money spent on Facebook on games. And social gaming as a destination is something different than the necessity of every game to have a social component. And you need that because, in the end, you want to entertain your people across all screens. So we're going to mix up some games and some metrics in this model, have some fun together, hopefully. But it is a serious business. It's not just for fun to take a different view of the market, because I think investors are a little bit lost in a market. And I'll explain later why. And we all know that consumers are spreading their budget across four screens now instead of two, putting pressure on single screen revenues. And cost of acquisition, there's a lot of talk about cost of acquisition today. And we all know that simply buying downloads is can be very, very expensive. You simply cannot make ends meet in your Excel. So suddenly you're forced to look at your market in a different way. Okay, this was from a keynote in London. The gap between investors and the games industry. Last Friday, VentureBeat, and I think Dean's here in the room, they published an overview of investments made into our industry and mergers and acquisitions. And something very dramatic can be seen here. The investment from outside investors into our industry has halved in a year's time. And at the same time, M&A money has gone up. So we understand our industry. We think we know where it's going. But increasingly so, the investors are taking their hands off of our industry. And I think that's something really serious. And one of the things I think we all need to watch out for a little bit is all the jargon. You know, like how Gaikai claimed the cloud gaming as a term and then turned that into $300 million. And now it's all about, you know, mid-core gaming, social casino gaming, and even mobile gaming. You know, it consists of a lot of components, and it might turn out to be a term only used for a short period. And, you know, this type of headline is not good for investors. And investors and CEOs only read headlines, so they see this. So we're taking a big risk. And then you have this type of headline coming from the local press. In Germany, you've got the same, and it's in the UK. In the US, it's sort of, it has improved. People mistakenly reporting on the total games market, while the figures below it are on part of the games market. So no way the overall games market is down 17.4%. It's even up 1, 2, or 3% if you look at all the business models, especially the business models that we all represent here. So this is a serious issue. Here, games market slump continues. Well, which investor would then invest in our market? So let's try to help him. Try to help him to look left and then look right before he crosses the street, or the other way around, depends on the country where you are. Because our market is pretty healthy. Now, if you look at a global level, it's growing 7% through the recession. That's cool. And there's regions where that are outperforming, of course. So this looks cool. The global picture is okay. And let's try to explain to investors what's going on. And let's not give them a list of 100 trends, but let's try to narrow it down. So I've been playing around with this. And you can come up to me. No, I'll tell you now. It's an animated GIF. That's why it's turning. Isn't that cool? So it's static PowerPoint and an animated GIF. I thought you were going to ask me afterwards, but I'll just tell you now how I did this. I thought it was pretty cool. So if you look at players and money, most reports are about players, how many gamers, how much money is earned. But in between are two important KPIs. That's time spent, and that's the share of people that spend money. And in between players and time, one of the trends is happening. We all know that there's four screens now. And if you look at the effect of those screens, you can see the number of players in Europe versus US, 8% up, like my lovely wife. But the time is up a lot more because there's more places, more occasions where you can play games. And then when you go, what happens in between? There's more time spent on games, and what's happened there in between time and paying players is the fact that games have become free. So that's the free-to-play business model. What effect does that have? It does not have the effect that less people spend money, it has the effect that more people spend money. Even 33% more people in America spend money on games than 1 year ago. That's really cool news. This is all good news for investors. And then in between paying people and the actual money, of course, is the fact that you have to manage the game as a service. You have to change your organization to be able to do that, to get more money out of those paying players. And you can see the money in the US up, Europe slightly up. But you can see that there's more coming. If we can manage the games more better like a service, there's more money coming our way. And I believe the market will return to an even healthier growth situation. Yeah, and balancing business models, is that a trend? It's a pretty new situation that a game has to cater to a person spending 10,000 a month on tanks and somebody spending 80 cents, all in the same game. And in the end, you need to create value for all those players. That's very, very difficult. And investors need to understand that because you need more time before you hit the sweet spot. Well, the interesting thing is the average spend is down 25% in the US, pretty dramatic. But if those new payers start to spend more, the market will go up. And of course, number five, we all know that, it's a global market for anyone, everyone now. If I slowly go through this with an investor, you can see he relaxes, he takes a sip of his coffee, and he thinks, now I sort of understand what's going on. Okay, and then he's looking for something to invest. He's looking for the not the rotten apple, but the red apple in the green apple basket. So they end up looking at these screens most often. And if you look at those screens from a global perspective, you know, about $9 billion going around, growing at about a third a year at this moment, which is really, really cool. A lot of players and a lot of paying gamers. But the most interesting of all is the fact that one third of all downloads are games, and $2 in $3 spent on smartphone and tablet games apps goes to games. The above figures might change in the course of the year, but the fact that a new screen monetizes best when it comes to games, that's not going to change. That's something that's sort of inherent to that screen and how it's used. So that's a continuous fact that's just very, very good news. So if we plot the mobile game stuff in this model, what happens then? Okay, 17% in the US, up in Europe. Oh, that's compared to the total market. Let's see, what facts am I presenting actually? Oh yeah. So mobile's up 17% versus the 1%, and this is for America. 34% more players, 69% more time spent in 1 year, and 35% more paying players. So the figures get even better. So this investor is looking then at mobile. I show him, yeah, that's a good choice because the figures are even better. And I hope that talking about the market in this way can put CEOs at ease or partners or investors. I hope it's going to help you. This is the bread that I make every morning for my research panel that you saw before. But we're spreading the budget across more screens, creating problems if you stick to only one screen with your game. And an interesting analysis that we did here was looking at the handheld consoles versus tablets versus smartphones. And you can see here that there's a lot of people who have a handheld console and a smartphone here, and those two do not compete. It's complementary. And you can see that even when you look at the US, this is, I think, September to the left, and then growth versus 6 months ago, that there's 52% more people in the US now that play games on a smartphone and a tablet than only 6 months ago. So the growth of that little segment shows that both screens are complementary, and we need to treat them that way. And you can also see that the tablets are really biting away at the handheld consoles very aggressively. So back to the screens again. So they're spreading the money across the screens. What happens if you plot money spent on these screens? Well, don't forget, the PC is the biggest screen when it comes to money. You know, we're all talking about mobile, but the computer screen takes 50% in the US of all money spent. And only 29% actually goes to the TV screen through the consoles. It's more interesting to look at paying players. So the money is, you know, it's not as high yet for the mobile screens, but what you can see here is the 37% that you see there, of all the paying gamers in the US, already more than a third spends money on one of those screens. And 32% of all the paying gamers in the US already spend money through the smartphone. So it confirms the idea that when you catch a paying player, he's probably spending money on all the other screens as well. So that might be an incentive to follow him. Oh yeah, and we're in Germany, so I just put the German figures in there as well. And overall, Germany is a bit more traditional. So the share of the mobile screens are a bit lower, but still it's about a third of the paying gamers in Germany already spend money on a tablet, and almost a third already on a smartphone. So that they're spending less on a single screen is obvious. Okay, let's see, do I have another animated GIF? No, this is not an animated GIF. I think we all know this this little game, World of Tanks. And we do a lot of cross analysis of players of certain franchises and then what they do with other franchises. And if you look at the countries above, there's about 13.5 million people that play World of Tanks. That's cool. Of those 13.5, almost 9 million spends money on MMO games, not particularly on World of Tanks. They might be spending it on World of Warcraft, but playing World of Tanks. But they're reaching about 9 million paying MMO gamers. And if you quickly translate that into money, you know, average spends about $12 or something a month, so $150 a year. So you're talking about what is it, 150 million? No, about 15, about the size of $1 billion people that you're reaching. At the same time, those people, they're reaching 4.1 million people that are spending money on a smartphone. And, well, you all know Victor, the CEO of Wargaming. I think he has changed his mind a little bit, but when I did a panel with him, I asked him, you know, what about mobile? Are you going to mobile? You need to go to mobile. And he said, mobile gaming is for pussies, he said. PC is for real games. They actually have a mobile group now, so that might change, but you can see that the average spend per month is $4 for a paying mobile gamer. So that's about 16 million a month that his gamers are spending on a smartphone. So it's tempting to tap into that. And it's cool to be able to put sort of a size of the prize on it. Now, this is the real stuff. This is a graph. I made this actually this morning. I didn't really know that we had it in our data explorer, as we call it. So people always ask me, okay, they're spending money on the smartphone. Are they spending it on the same type of games? Or are they playing Angry Birds in the train and then at evening, World of Tanks? So I just generated a graph comparing German Temple Run gamers and Kingdoms of Camelot. So sort of more a casual genre and more a strategy game. And you can see, what you can see here is, if you look at sort of the third one, World of Warcraft, so 59% of the Kingdoms of Camelot players in Germany also plays World of Warcraft. And for League of Legends, it's very high. So only 13% of the Temple Run people play League of Legends and 42% of the Kingdoms of Camelot people. So there is a big genre connection between the screens. And that could be very good news if you want to develop an offering on a different screen than you're at now. And there's probably a lot more interesting stuff in this graph, but I've only myself spent about 10 minutes looking at it. So please realize that, you know, if you're reaching a paying gamer, you're probably only taking about 30% of their wallet for maximum. And a paying player is very hard to find, very expensive, we all know that. So it's almost forcing us to do stuff with that paying gamer on other screens. Cost of acquisition. I think that's the theme of one of the panels today. Some people say it's $7 now, and I'm not sure about the exact data, but it's gone up significantly. And if you're having a very metrics-driven approach, especially like the Asians have, you have your whole Excel, you have cost of acquisition, ARPU, lifetime value and stuff, and then suddenly this goes up, and then your whole system doesn't work anymore. So I spend a lot of time explaining Asians that you might need to take a different approach, not simply buying downloads in Europe, but looking at the screens and doing more traditional marketing. But of course, we're crazy about those metrics. So we know exactly what Clash of Clans makes in every country in the world, and it's cool to see that, and what happens when they do a release, version 3.3. You can see the downloads go up, the revenues go up, but how much do they go up? That's really fun stuff. So yes, we do that. And we put a lot of rankings up for free. This is the Play Store ranking across 17 countries across the globe. Really cool to see how global the market is, because it's a mix of Asian publishers, Western publishers. I think that's really cool, just for a reference. So if you focus on that one screen and you're running through the funnel of cost of acquisition, something goes wrong if your cost of acquisition is too high. Oops, you then say. So please prepare for a multi-screen view or approach of the market. And you need to be, you need to have social networks involved, you need to do stuff via the cloud, you need to be present in the real world, at least I think so. Yeah, and that's content that travels best, and who has the best content? That's us, that's game companies, so it should for us be relatively easy. I just want to have some facts up here, and you can all download the presentation as a reference. It still is true that Google Play is behind, but it is impressive how in other countries in Asia, for instance, it's taking a significant chunk, and this does not include Amazon. So yeah, the gap is closing, but it's still iOS dominating. And in American press, I see a lot of publications about women and mobile gaming. But don't forget, women play, but men pay. Because the majority of paying gamers is still men. I think even in casual gaming, there's more paying men than you would expect. Here you can see, if you look at Apple and Play Store, the demographics are different. People have simply more money to spend who have an iOS device and have a full-time job compared to Play Store. Yeah, this is almost the last one. If you're thinking of the multi-screen approach and taking a step back, data can inspire you to do innovative stuff. Like this graph shows you that there's 980,000 paying female mobile gamers just walking around the CNA, a clothing store. Just walking around there. And maybe you should partner with CNA. Nobody's doing that now. Get your prepaid cards in CNA or do a branded clothing with CNA. So what I'm trying to do here is data is not only metrics, it's also a way to inspire you to do creative marketing to get out of the cost of the acquisition problem. So in an ideal world, you have metrics and consumer data, and that's exactly what we're about. We mix it all up. And if you want to work with us, you will not be the first, so don't be scared. And let's work together to close that gap and to get the investors back into our market. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. I think we have time for one or maybe two questions for Peter, if there are any in the audience. I had just one, and I wonder if you've actually got any insights on the propensity for players who cross screen to want to play the same game or to want to continue their gaming experience across screens versus playing something else.
Yeah, well, as you saw in that graph, it doesn't provide the actual exact answer to that. In our upcoming research round, it's a hot topic. For now, they expect to find their favorite game brand on every screen. It doesn't particularly mean that you need have to play the game there, but if you look in the App Store and your favorite game, if you put in League of Legends and don't find anything, people find that very, very weird. I don't have very hard data to back that stuff up, but please ask me again in April, because then I will have it.
You can count on it.
Sorry, yeah.
Thank you very much, Peter.